Welcome everyone to The New Fly Fisher. I'm your host, Phil Rowley. Today we're coming to you from beautiful, scenic West Yellowstone, Montana, home of some of the world's best trout streams. I'm joined by legendary fly fisher Bob Jacklin, and Bob's going to show me and you his favorite fall strategies for taking trout in this beautiful area. Stick around, it's going to be a great show.
Let him go back to live another day.
And away he goes. Great fish. Wow.
Oh, baby.
Look at that fish.
Stop. Wiggle. On the way down.
The New Fly Fisher has been made possible thanks to West Yellowstone Chamber of Commerce, the State of Montana, Islander Precision Reels, and Orvis Sporting Traditions.
Today, the New Fly Fisher comes to you from West Yellowstone, Montana. The West Yellowstone region is an area of stunning beauty and the springboard to some of the West's most outstanding trout waters. Bordering the western entrance to the world-famous Yellowstone National Park, the area is a naturalist's dream. Rich concentrations of wildlife, including bison, grizzly bears, and wolves abound. West Yellowstone is also steeped in fly fishing culture. Home to the annual Federation of Fly Fishers Conclave, it is one of the few places where someone casting on the lawn of the West Yellowstone Museum is seen as commonplace. The West Yellowstone area is blessed with an abundance of affordable accommodations and great restaurants, perfect for any fly fisher's budget. Our guide today is world-class fisherman, fly caster, and tire Bob Jacklin. Bob has taught countless people how to fly fish and has owned his shop and guide service for over 30 years. He has been guiding in the West Yellowstone area since 1969. Bob knows the region's streams intimately, and we are looking forward to exploring some of his favorite fall waters.
This area here is really unique. This is the main Madison River as it comes out of Hebgen Dam and flows into Quake Lake. Here we have the large pteranorsis salmon fly in the spring. We've got some green drakes later. We got a whole host of caddis, golden stone. We got everything you can imagine hatches out here through the season of the year, starting about mid-June into pretty much October. But this time of year, in early September, we still have a lot of hoppers around. And if you look up in the sky, we're seeing some flying ants. So today I'm going to start out with a grasshopper fly. We're not going to catch a lot, but we might bring up a big fish. That's what we're after.
Terrestrials are insects that do not have any aquatic component to their life cycle. They become important when their habits and numbers get themselves on the water in front of opportunistic trout. By late summer, many terrestrial insects are mature, active, and available. Grasshoppers, ants, beetles, crickets, even bees and wasps form an important dietary component for all trout and whitefish in the late summer and fall. Up ahead of us, we've got a junction of two current seams, two arms of the river coming together. Bob spotted a couple of fish there already. Bob, how are you going to approach this?
I'm going to stick this one on the right side. I'm going to get down on hands and knees, close as I can, to make a short cast, but I want it to be accurate.
Well,
the first cast,
again.
There he is again. The first cast has got to be right on target. And that fish appears to be feeding on little olives. I was going to use the hopper, but I think I'll change. And I'll match the hatch. We'll put on a little olive fly and see if I can't take that fish on an olive.
Let's go do it.
I got a light tippet, so I hope I don't break them off. But let's give them a try. That fly might be a little big. Jesus.
That was almost like he came up at last minute, changed his mind.
Yeah, he did that. Yep, exactly right. He never took the fly. but he sure came up on it. Jesus.
There's a head and tail rise, Bob. See that? Off your right shoulder?
Over up here?
Yeah, it was a head tail. That was a snout of a trout.
Yeah, that's, I'm looking for that.
That was a delicate, you could just see the tip of his nose come up.
See that second time. I had a wake underneath that fly, but he didn't take the fly. Most of them are whitefish, I think, but that one's a trout. Good brown, good fish. Maybe a rainbow, I think. Whatever it is, a good fish. Finally, a little nice rainbow. Taking my slack. I got a lot of slack because I was casting a long line, so. Get down the river and fight him down. Not real big, but he's 2 pounds, maybe a little better. That's a good fish. Taking a little line. I thought that was a big brown for sure. Saw him. I'm gonna get down here and get in the water and see if I can net him. Nice and easy. Bring him down, head in. Got him. All right, Lem, you can take my rod.
Yeah, I'll do that.
And maybe I can get in here with the hemostat and take that fly out. It's in the roof of his mouth.
And then,
all right, I'm gonna show the fish and we're gonna let him go.
Just hold him.
We can show them tight. Oh, nice big 20-inch rainbow.
Gorgeous fish.
On a dry fly, let's let him go and let's let him swim away. There he goes. Perfect. Notice he headed right to the bank for cover. I thought that was a brown.
That's a good white fish.
Phil, when we come back, you get this pool. Oh, smoke. You may want to drift a little nymph under a...
Hopper.
Exactly. I'll try it in close here, and I'll get out of your way and new fish.
Yeah. Be a few minutes yet, so.
Well, there's a trout. I hope we get some rising fish on this. They're not taking on dry. Well, that one took a dry, I saw it. That one actually took the dry, small olive.
So what we've done again is, Bob's recommended, we've seen fish rising. We believe to hoppers, we've got maize, we've even got some gray drakes starting to pop off. So, but we've seen fish flashing down there. We believe them to be white fish, and this has confirmed it, because I've put a hopper pattern on and a small gold bead pheasant tail, and just watch that dry fly drift along and then pull under. Very exciting. Very, very exciting way to fish.
I'll back you up if you want. I'm here.
There we go.
Got the net.
And we'll get the net ready. Try not to horse him, small fly. But these whitefish are a lot of fun, and this is a good sized fish.
That's a big whitefish.
That's a big whitefish.
They'll only exist in good quality water, too. You won't find whitefish in water that's only fair. They have got real good water. I always say better water than trout.
Well, that's...
I don't know if that's a fact, but these are good fish.
That's a fat whitefish. So there we go, a gorgeous whitefish. You can see their underslung mouth, which they try to take dries, but they're not always successful. We'll continue to work upstream, see if we can get some trout or some more beautiful whitefish like this. Your turn, Bob.
I don't know, I'd like to see you get another one. You hooked two. Phil, look at this undercut bank, and this whole stream is loaded with these. That's plenty deep enough for an 18-inch brown just to take and sip anything coming down, or he could see everything out in the pool right there. So look at that, it's perfect.
Yeah, wonderful spot for them to hide, especially on these sunny days.
Yeah.
Water's on the water, they're gonna tuck in
under
there.
They got cover and feed, got everything.
Just slide out, grab something, slide back in.
Yep, perfect. Well, let's go upstream and see what we can find.
Okay.
Undercut banks are an important feature of many streams. Trout and other fish use these banks as a form of protection, venturing out to ambush prey as it drifts by. Make a point of targeting undercut banks, especially those covered by shade and overhanging vegetation. Avoid encroaching the edge of an undercut. Walk softly and carefully. Heavy footsteps transmit through the water, alerting fish of your presence.
Yeah, walk up in there and get right up to your left and in front of you. Yeah, further up. Yeah, right there. Get in
right,
there.
Right where that current pushes
Yeah,
again.
Right on the current and all the way down through the pool. Right on the bank. The deepest water. It's undercut bank, too. Real undercut.
Okay.
Be ready. Be nice to get him grabbing there. Right. Ooh,
got him.
Good fish.
Got him.
Good fish.
Came up and ate the hopper.
Excellent.
Well, that's a good fish. That's a good fish.
I'm gonna go
well coached, Bob. Well coached.
Bring him down this way. Maybe we can get another one out of there.
Yeah, he's trying to take me back under into his
Looks
home.
Looks like a good fish.
That's a great fish. Just come up and
sipped it.
It's a breezy day, hopper pattern.
Now we're talking.
Just sipped her down. First drift in there.
Perfect.
What a gorgeous fish.
All right. What a nice trophy.
Yeah, we'll just let the rod absorb the.
Yeah.
There, his head's up.
Got him. Well, big brown. Hey, Woo. Phil.
That's is a what good... we're talking about.
Well, so his head is upriver and he's breathing nicely. This is another 20 inch fish. I got a nice rainbow, and Phil got this nice brown first cast right there.
What a fish. So I'm going to wet my hands. Oh, that water's
right,
cool.
I got the net, so you want to hold them up for the camera. We'll let them go. Look at that.
Look at that.
Yeah, let me get out of the
light. Beautiful Montana brown. Look
That's
at that.
A Montana brown for sure.
That's why you come to Montana in the fall. Gorgeous fish.
On a dry fishing. Fly, on a hopper.
On hoppers. They've been blowing into the water.
Nice.
What a gorgeous
Face
fish.
Face them upstream and let's let them swim.
That's right.
Here we go. Right upriver.
Yeah,
put
get
him
the,
in there and let him go.
And just sit there and he'll, when
there
he's
he
ready,
goes.
He's getting ready. Make sure he's good and strong. And there he goes. Wow.
That's what it's all about, Phil.
Thanks,
right
Bob.
There. Sneak
what
it up.
Great coaching.
On your hands and knees, one cast, hopper land right in the center of the pool and wham.
Up he came. Nose poke took it down.
That was classic.
Wonderful, wonderful fishing. You got to come do this.
It's right near, this is like how many? 4 miles from West Yellowstone.
Yeah, unbelievable.
Right near town. So it's perfect. That's one of my favorite little places here. You don't catch a lot of fish here.
But
there's a
all...
couple of good ones, and we worked hard. We each got one so far today. So for the average fisherman, for myself, I'd be happy.
I love this.
One fish, that's it.
I love this.
This is nice.
One of the challenges when you're working a meadow stream like this and fishing terrestrials is dealing with the wind. And that's frankly what put the insects in the river in the first place, so we kind of need it. But the wind today is coming into my face, and if I do with a traditional right-handed approach, because I'm a right-handed caster, I run the risk of actually having that fly drift into my face. So if I take my cast and actually place the rod like on this angle, so the flies and the fly line is traveling over my left shoulder, the wind is pushing it away from me, it's safer, and I can still make a great presentation. So think about that the next time you're working a terrestrial pattern or any dry fly into the wind. Flow that downstream again and get it all fed out.
That wind's helping too with this hopper stuff.
Well, you just got to pick your window, right?
Yeah.
All right. Ooh. Oh, that was another brown. Just had a brown come up and roll in my fly. I don't think I stuck him. In other words, I didn't prick him with the hooks. There's a good chance he'll come back. So my hopper was a little drowned. Hoppers float low, but I'm just putting a little dry fly powder on it. Dry it off. I'm gonna throw it, pitch it back in there and see if I can coax him to come up again. Got something.
Good. Took the nymph. Oh, that's got to be a trout fighting like that.
I'm not sure.
Nice.
No, it's a good-sized whitefish.
Good-sized white? Nice.
Yeah. But That's a good sized whitefish.
Nice.
Took the little betis nymph I got underneath. Little, basically a beadhead pheasant tail on a curved scud hook. So just cleaning up my line here. Trying to keep him out of the pool if I can, if there's anybody else home there. Could have been him that come up. I don't know. I thought it was a brown, but it all happens so fast, you're never sure, sure sometimes.
Well, that's a big whitefish.
Yeah.
Here's a nice whitefish. The temperature of this water, Phil, is 43 degrees. It's ice cold water year round.
Whoop, where's he gone? There he is.
Going to show you how bad of a job I can do netting fish. Whoa. Come on, Jacqueline. Oop, he's gone. Broke them all.
Broke them
all. Oh, he got the hopper.
Oh, he got just the hopper. All right, well, we'll go back. That's okay. We'll go back in there and get him.
Get back there and get another one.
Yeah, we'll just go hopper time this time.
Bob is a Federation of Fly Fishers certified master caster. During the season, Bob frequently provides free casting lessons from his shop. Let's watch and listen as Bob demonstrates some of his favorite casting techniques to combat windy conditions.
Okay, we're here in the West Yellowstone area. There's always a lot of wind, whether it's springtime, fall, summertime. You're always working with the wind or against the wind. So one cast I use when the wind's blowing at my face from my right side, being right-handed, I do what we call a Belgium cast. I bring the rod and tip low and over the top. That keeps the fly low so the wind doesn't blow it right into your face. You keep it low and over the top. So that makes a really good cast. The other thing we do in the wind is change in direction a lot of times. We cast the line out. It flows down that way. We just take it and we roll it up in the air, change direction, and we can lay it up again this way. I do that again. When the fly comes down, we pick it up and we roll it up. Pick it up, it's called a roll cast pickup. I'll do that again. Bring the rod up, make a roll cast in the air, and present the fly. So these are things we can do in the wind. If the wind is blowing right at you, you want your back cast high and force it down into the wind. It's not a pretty cast, but it'll get the fly where you want it. So high and force it down into the wind. Opposite is true. When the wind's blowing with you, you make your back cast low and you go high for a long cast out. We'll do that again. Back cast low, forward cast high, let the wind take it on out. So these are some things we do in the wind, but we go back to basics with the roll cast pickup and present the fly. There's a lot of things we can do with that wind, and you want to practice your casting as much as possible. If you want the line up here and it's down here, make a roll, do a pickup, and present the fly right upriver. So there's a lot of things you can do in the wind, but when it's real bad, the worst cast, blowing from my right side, you turn around and you cast it backwards. If that doesn't work, it's time to go home.
This is one of the reasons you always turn over rocks and logs whenever you go fishing, spring, summer, fall, like we are now on the Madison. The Madison's known for its salmon fly hats. That's why these fish, as Bob says, have a tendency to look up. And these are a big, big animal. This is a huge stonefly, the pteranarsis, the salmon flies. Look at the size of these things. And this is why you always want to turn over the rocks and logs, find out what's living there, and then choose a fly to match either the nymph or the adult stage. These things are just huge.
Years ago, the standard rod was a 7-weight rod, and that's 40 years ago. But nowadays, everything's 5-weight. So with the wind, sometimes a 5-weight rod, good and stiff with a 6-line on it will be perfect. A 7-weight occasionally, but your best outfit's an all-around 5-weight outfit. If you only have one rod and it's 6-weight, bring that, that's fine too. If you got a 4-weight, 3-weight, bring the rod. Sometimes without wind, it's kind of fun using a light tackle. But really, a 5-weight is all around.
Upstream.
I saw it.
Good fish. Fish on.
Fish on. Good fish. He's fighting like a trout. I don't know. Let's see. No, whitefish. Nice fish, though. Took that hopper right on top. There he goes, taking line. Good fish. They taking more line. That's a nice fish on a hopper any day.
Nothing wrong with that.
Nothing wrong with that. Good fish. Yep. Let me get out here in the water and I'll net them. You want to net them?
Yeah, go ahead. I can net them for you, Bob.
Okay, great.
There we go.
Holy, what a good whitefish. There's about 3-pound, 4-pound whitefish.
You don't want to play them too long. Let him go. I'm going to let him go really quick. Are you ready?
Okay, we'll just go.
Get a nice shot of him.
Yeah, so let me get
look at that whitefish. All
right. Well done, Bob.
Took that hopper right on the top.
Wow. Fall is terrestrial time, isn't it here, Bob?
It is.
Very, very popular.
Yep, the trout are. The trout in this West Yellowstone area, the whole West, they're used to feeding on large insects, big mayflies, big cats, stoneflies. When it comes to the fall, they'll get their share of hoppers, so they're kind of used to feeding on top something big. You give them something big, but there is a catch. You have to have a perfect float. It's got to be a long tippet. When that hopper lands, it can't move, it can't twitch. It's got to go exactly with the current or you won't see a thing. If you can do that, watch out, and that's what happened.
Well, let's go back and do it again.
Yeah, now it's your turn.
Okay.
You get out there and get another one out of that pool.
It's been great.
Thanks a lot. That
was
a good fish. I enjoyed it.
It's been a pleasure fishing with a master. I've learned so much. Hopefully you at home have learned a lot. For more information on this show and other shows in our informative series, please visit us on the web at thenewflyfisher.com. Thanks for watching. We'll see you next week.
The New Fly Fisher has been made possible thanks to West Yellowstone Chamber of Commerce, the State of Montana, Islander Precision Reels, and Orvis Sporting Traditions.